I'm standing in front of the greatest pyramid in the land of Egypt. It was built by Pharaoh Khufu, or if you prefer his Greek name, Cheops, of the 4th dynasty. Experts and scholars still wonder today at these amazing feats of architecture and engineering. And later during the program, we'll be showing you the internal workings of this particular pyramid on a to-scale model. In the meantime, however, let's go back in time with David Down as we take you back through the exciting history of the great dynasties of Egypt.
Well, there were 30 or 31 dynasties in the history of ancient Egypt, depending on whether you include the last Persian dynasty or not. A dynasty, you know, is where a king is succeeded by his son, and so long as it stays in the family, it's a dynasty. Well, the first king of the first dynasty was a king by the name of Menes, and these kings were buried in what are known as mastabas. Now, these are stone mastabas over here of the fourth dynasty. But the kings of the first and second dynasty were buried in mud brick mastabas. Now, when we come to the third dynasty, there was a dramatic development, and we find that at Saqqara. Let's go there and have a look. We are now at the so-called step pyramid of Saqqara, which you can see over here. And in this pyramid, we have two significant steps forward. It was made for King Djoser of the third dynasty by his architect Imhotep. And in the first place, instead of using mud bricks, as did the pharaohs of the first and second dynasties, it is made of stone. Pretty rough stone, to be sure, but nevertheless, it's made of stone. And secondly, we have here six stages altogether. First of all, it started off as a mastaba, and then four stages were placed on top of that. Then later on, two more stages, making six stages altogether. But how do we know that this is how the pyramid was built? Well, around the south side, where the stone robbers have removed the outer facing of the pyramid, you can see where the mastaba was originally. And then around the east side, you can see the joints. See where it's been added on here? And so the archaeologists have been able to put the whole thing together, and we know just how it was done. Now, the question is, where did this concept come from? Where did Imhotep get this great idea? It's assumed that he just had a brainwave and built up the stages one by one, thought after thought. I personally don't agree with that. I consider that this whole concept was borrowed from Mesopotamia. You see, there was more communication between Mesopotamia and Egypt than is generally assumed, I think. And in Mesopotamia, where civilization began, we have what is known as ziggurats. For instance, there's the ziggurat of Ur of the Chaldees. There's the Tower of Babel in Babylon, and there's Burz Nimrod. There are numerous ziggurats, and they were stage upon stage. Now, the only difference was that whereas these ziggurats were used for worship, they used to go up on top there and worship on top, this idea was used for burial. So you don't go up on top, it was simply a burial chamber underneath. And actually, there's a more complex series of passages and tomb chambers underneath here than any other pyramid or any other burial place in the whole of the land of Egypt. It's absolutely amazing. Now, from here, we can see three pyramids in the distance as we look south, and they all belong to one king. Now, not even a god king can be buried in three places at once. So why did this king want three pyramids in which to be buried? What you're looking at is not really the final pyramid. You're just looking at the square core. Originally, this was the first true pyramid form. Now, what we saw at Saqqara, so-called step pyramid, which I don't consider to be a pyramid at all, went up in stages. But here we have the development of the first true pyramid form. It went right up straight on the outside. But you'll notice that the outside is gone. It's fallen down. The question is, what happened? Well, it's like this. If we were to go in the entrance, we would find that there's a descending corridor going right down, and then a horizontal passage going along, and at the end of that, there are some large cedar beams there holding the stones together. And from there, we go straight up into the centre, the very heart of the pyramid, and up there is the tomb chamber. But you'll notice something about it. It's not finished, never was finished. And after all, this is what a pyramid is all about, for the burial of the king. That's the most important part. Okay, so why wasn't it finished? Well, the question is, did this outside covering collapse slowly, disintegrate over thousands of years, or as Kurt Mendelssohn, an engineer incidentally, not an archaeologist, but maybe an engineer knows more about this, he claims that it was a sudden collapse and it happened before the pyramid was entirely finished. And that would explain, of course, just why it was abandoned. After all, it must have been like an earthquake when it all came tumbling down. So what was the king going to do? Well, he could clear the rubble away and start again, maybe, but maybe there's some superstitious reason that he decided not to do that. And so he decided to go elsewhere. And so we have the second pyramid, which is the bent pyramid. Now, it's called the bent pyramid because it goes up at an angle of 54 degrees and then levels off to 43 degrees. Now, the question is why? Well, some people say he ran out of money, finished it off more economically. Others say he died and his son finished it off. Well, I'll tell you what his son would have been doing. His son would have been busy starting building his own, you see. So what is more likely is that he got it up halfway and then he realized that this also could collapse. Actually, there are some stress strains, some cracks in that pyramid, which suggests there was a problem. Now, that being the case, maybe he said, well, look, we better finish it off at a lower angle so as to see that it doesn't collapse. But the stress strains were there. So maybe that accounts for the third pyramid. Now, the third pyramid, the red pyramid of Dahshur, was finished off, the whole thing, at 43 degrees. And I guess he figured, well, here's one pyramid which is not going to come down on top of me after I'm buried there. So I think this is undoubtedly the reason why he had three pyramids. There's just one other interesting point about this, and that is, people ask me, how long did it take to build the pyramids? Well, most people refer to Herodotus, the ancient historian about in the 5th century BC, who says that the Great Pyramid of Khufu, the ramp leading up to it, the causeway, took about 10 years, and the pyramid itself 20 years. But listen, 30 years. The pharaohs didn't rule that long. They had no guarantee they're going to be still alive at the end of 30 years. But on the other hand, the bent pyramid of Dahshur has an inscription down the bottom in which it refers to the 21st year of the king. And halfway up is another inscription with the 22nd year of the king. It means it only took 1 year to get from the bottom to halfway up. The whole thing probably finished in 2 years. So maybe Khufu's pyramid was finished in about 2 or 3 years. I think that's more likely. Well, you wouldn't want to have claustrophobia to go into that pyramid. And look, while we're here, just over there is a mastaba. I think we should go in there and have a look. The original entrance to this mastaba is round on the east side, but it was blocked up when the mastaba was first made, so nobody has ever gone in there since. But we have to go in here, which is the entrance that was made by the tomb robbers to get everything out of the mastaba of value. Well, you can see they didn't make a very big hole. In fact, you have to really squeeze through here to get into the tomb chamber. Now, when you get through there, you can see the stone plugs that blocked up the original entrance. That's why the tomb robbers had to make their own entrance. And here you can see the sarcophagus in which the body was buried in the tomb chamber. Well, it was pretty hard to get in and out of there. Well, now we go to the biggest pyramid of all, Sneferu's son, Khufu, or Cheops. Thank you. this is the pyramid of Khufu, or Greek name Cheops. And what a massive monument this is. Do you realise just how many stones are in this thing? It has been estimated that there are 2,300,000 blocks of stone in this colossal monument. And on the average, each stone is about 2.5 tons in weight. The biggest of them is 15 tons. You know, there's just so many stones in this pyramid that suppose we do it this way. If we took some of these stones and we cut them into pieces, blocks, 30 centimetres by 30 centimetres, and we put one block here and another block beside it and another one and so forth, just keep on going. Do you know, we could go right round the coast of Australia and we've still only used half the blocks of stone in this pyramid. We could go right round again. That's a colossal number of stones, you know. Well, people ask me, how did they get these stones up there in the first place? There are no tomb inscriptions, there's no reference in any of the statements in the ancient writers as to how this was done. The only clue we have is the fact that at Karnak there is a pylon there, and there are some mud bricks going up, and they never removed them. And that gives us the clue that this was the way they got these big stones right up onto the top of these pylons or up these pyramids. So undoubtedly that's the way it was up here, no mystery about it at all. This pyramid is colossal. From one corner to the other is 229 metres. Now do you realise that in order to walk right around you're going to go more than 1 kilometre? The height is 146 metres. Well, that's what it is today anyway. You might notice the top is a little bit flat. It's 10 metres lower today. That's because local builders have taken stones from the top for their own building purposes in Cairo. Well, how was this pyramid entered? What was it like at the beginning? Well, we'll go around the other side and have a look at that. Now, we're around the north side of the pyramid, and this is where the official entrance was. In fact, if you look up there, you can see the keystones, the arch, and that was where the official entrance was, and from there a descending corridor slopes down right into the very heart of the pyramid. But in order to see just what the inside passages and tomb chambers are like, we need to have a look at a model of the pyramid, take it apart, and then you'll be able to understand what the inside of this pyramid is like. Now, you can see here the original entrance. When it was finished, of course, this was covered up so that you couldn't see it. It's slightly off-centre. Here's about the centre here, and here is Mamun's entrance, where they illegally dug in there, and that's where visitors, tourists go in there today. I have made it so that we can take it apart, and you can see the passages inside. Now, over here is the entrance and the descending passage going down into bedrock, and then it levels off and goes to a tomb chamber, which is unfinished. Here are these... is the ascending passageway, and it was blocked off here with a slab of stone so that anyone going down here would not know that the passage was there. But that's the slab of stone that fell down when the workmen of Mamun started digging through there. You'll notice it's blocked up by three large slabs of stone here, and then the passage goes right up here. It goes level here, horizontal, to what is known as the Queen's Chamber, and there are two vents coming up here, only they go nowhere. Then here is the ascending gallery, and it comes up here and then levels off and goes into the king's chamber. And up the end there is the sarcophagus. There are five gaps above here to relieve the pressure of the immense, enormous amount of stone that's above it, crushing it. And it was in here that a workman had scribbled the name of Khufu, and that's how we can identify this pyramid. There are two small passages going up here. They're only small, and air vents, what are they? I don't think so. But anyway, they come up here and right out to the outside. So this gives you an idea of what the inside of the pyramid looks like. Now, there is one more very interesting aspect of this pyramid. People often ask me, how old are the pyramids? Well, by the usually accepted chronology, these pyramids were built about 2600 BC. But if we accept the biblical chronology, it means that the universal flood occurred about 2300 BC. Now, that means that this pyramid would have to be later than that. In fact, according to Dr. Emmanuel Velikovsky's revised chronology, it would place it about the 19th century BC, and that would be about the time that Abraham visited Egypt. You know, you have the record in the book of Genesis of Abraham coming down here to Egypt and talking with the Pharaoh and so forth. Now, remember where Abraham came from. He came from Ur of the Chaldees. And Sir Leonard Woolley's excavations there from 1922 to 1934 revealed that the Sumerian civilization was the world's first civilization. And they had a remarkable understanding of mathematics and astronomy and trigonometry and other sciences. Well, now, Josephus, the Jewish historian, made a very interesting statement. And I want you to listen to what that statement says.
Abraham communicated to them, that is the Egyptians, arithmetic, and delivered to them the science of astronomy. For before Abraham came into Egypt, they were unacquainted with those parts of learning, for that science came from the Chaldeans into Egypt.
So, if that is correct, and Abraham came here during the time of Khufu, that would explain something very interesting. You see, this pyramid is exactly square. It is exactly level. It is exactly orientated north, south, east and west. And if you were to take a circle with the top of the pyramid as the center of the circle and apply the formula 2 pi r, you would find that that would be the exact circumference of the base of the pyramid. Well, now, either that's a remarkable coincidence or it means that the Egyptians at this time knew the formula 2 pi r. And where did they get it from? Well, if Abraham imparted to them this knowledge, that would explain it all. And so it raises the interesting possibility that the Egyptians may indeed, as Josephus says, have learned their astronomy and their mathematics from Abraham, who brought it from Ur of the Chaldees. Or to give him his Greek name, Khephren. And he built this next pyramid, not quite as big as the preceding one, but it's still a big beauty, isn't it? And the interesting part of this pyramid is right up at the top, do you see it, is still part of the stone facing that originally covered both pyramids. Tura limestone, beautiful white glistening limestone it was. Well, most of it is gone, taken by the stone robbers actually, but there's that little bit still left up the top there to enable us to know just what these pyramids looked like when they were finished. Now, Khafre had an interesting system. He wanted to stay there forever. He wanted his body to be preserved forever. And so he devised an idea to guarantee that no tomb robbers would ever get into his tomb. Well, this was his idea. He had a sphinx made here. It was cut out of the solid rock. You see that knoll over there? Well, there was one like that here, and they cut the stone away from it and left this sphinx standing, a human face and a lion's body. It's 73 metres long and 20 metres high, and it has the face of Khafre, so we know it was meant to be guarding his tomb. But it didn't do a very good job, because his tomb was robbed anyway by the tomb robbers. So we leave the pyramid of Khafre, and we go to the next pyramid, which is a lot smaller, and that was the pyramid of Menkaure, or to give him his Greek name, Mykerinus. It's a lot smaller, only about a quarter of the size of the preceding one. But the interesting part about this pyramid is that it was covered not with white Tura limestone, but with this beautiful pink granite that was floated down the River Nile, nearly 1,000 kilometres from Aswan. And this covered nearly half of the bottom of the pyramid. Most of it has fallen down, of course. But let's have a look at the top of this pyramid. It's rather interesting. Well, here we are at the top, and believe me, it's a long way up. But it's worth it. Away out over there are the pyramids of Abu Sir. Now, they're the pyramids of the pharaohs of the 5th dynasty. They're in very bad shape. They have crumbled right down. But in particular, I want to tell you about the last king of the 5th dynasty, whose name was Unas. So here we are at the Pyramid of Unas over there. It's in rather poor condition, all the outside stone is gone, but the inside is interesting. There's a new development here. Let's go down and have a look. Well, we're a long way below ground level here, but Unas wanted his soul to have the impression that he was underneath the night sky, and so he had all these stars painted on the roof of his tomb chamber. As well as the stars and the roof, there's another very important feature here, and that is the introduction of these beautiful hieroglyphic texts in a tomb for the first time. Now, up until 1822, nobody could read these texts, but then came the Rosetta Stone. In 1798, Napoleon Bonaparte's forces crossed the Mediterranean and he occupied Egypt. Soon after, one of his officers was rebuilding a fort at a place called Rashid in the Delta, now known as Rosetta, and he found there a strange stone, which he sent up to Cairo. Subsequently, the British occupied Egypt and confiscated the stone. So the Rosetta Stone is now in the British Museum, and as you can see, it is in three different scripts. It was a French genius by the name of Champollion who was ultimately able to announce that he was able to decipher the Egyptian hieroglyphs in the year 1822. The way he was able to do it was from this Rosetta Stone. At the top, there is the Egyptian ancient hieroglyph pictorial writing. Beneath that, in the center, is the Demotic, which is also the Egyptian language, but in a cursive script. And down below here is the same message in the Greek script and language. Now, this could be read, the Greek could be read, and so by comparing this with the Demotic and then with the hieroglyphs, ultimately Champollion was able to announce that he could interpret the hieroglyphs. So now the Egyptologists can read these beautiful hieroglyphic texts, and the result is some very interesting light on a biblical story. Behind me is a hill on which once stood the ancient city of Dothan, and it was in this vicinity that one of those stories which is sometimes stranger than fiction took place. It was the story of Joseph, the son of Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, and one of them was Joseph, the second youngest was Joseph. And Joseph was a very good boy. Jacob loved him very much, but he made the fatal mistake of showing favoritism towards this son. And he even made him what the Bible calls a coat of many colours. Actually, that's not a good translation. It should be a coat with long sleeves. Do you know why? Because if you had long sleeves, that meant that you weren't expected to do any manual work. Well, the other brothers, of course, had to go out and do their work. And one day they left the home and went out with their flocks to Shechem. And after they were away for a while, their father got a bit anxious and said to Joseph, "You better go and see how they're getting on." So Joseph went. Now, Joseph had had some dreams in which he dreamed that sheaves from a wheat field like this were bowing down, 11 of them were bowing down and worshipping him. And, of course, the brothers interpreted this as meaning that one day they would bow down to him. And, of course, they didn't like that. And they resented this, you see. Well, when Joseph came to Shechem, he found that the brothers had already left, and they told him they'd gone on to Dothan. So that means they came onto this place here. And when the brothers saw Joseph coming, they said, "Aha, here comes that dreamer. Now listen, let's kill him and then let us see what happens to his dreams." And so they all thought that was a good idea. And so when poor unsuspecting Joseph came, they grabbed hold of him. But Reuben, the oldest of the brothers, didn't want to have to go back to his father and tell this story. And so he said, "Listen, don't let's kill him. Let us throw him into this pit," referring to a nearby cistern.
This well is at the foot of the hill on which Dothan is built. The stones up near the top are of fairly recent origin, but those stones down the bottom are very old. Well, it is possible that into this pit, which was dry at the time, Joseph was lowered with the intention of leaving him there by the brothers. However, after a while, Judah came along and he said, look, why don't we make a quick shekel out of this? And a caravan of camels was coming along and he said, let's sell him as a slave. Well, these Midianite traders took Joseph down to Egypt, and there they sold him to an officer by the name of Potiphar. Apparently Joseph decided if he was going to be a slave, he might as well be a good one, and he was so reliable that Potiphar promoted him to be the head over his household. Unfortunately for Joseph, there was some false accusation made against him, and he was flung into prison. Well, while he was in prison there, the two servants of Pharaoh, a butler and a baker, were also flung into prison, and one day Joseph came along and he found them looking very disconsolate. And he said, what's your problem? Well, the butler said, we've had some dreams and we don't know what the meaning is. Oh, Joseph said, tell me, I'll tell you the meaning, God knows the meaning. So the butler said, well, I dreamed that I had three bunches of grapes and I squeezed them into Pharaoh's cup. Oh, Joseph said, that's easy. It simply means that after 3 days you're going to be restored as Pharaoh's butler to squeeze the grapes into his cup. Well, when the baker heard that, he thought, that's pretty good. And he said, well, I dreamed that I had three baskets of bread on my head, and the birds came and ate up the bread. Joseph said, that means that after 3 days you're going to lose your head. Well, it happened just exactly as Joseph had predicted. And when the butler was restored, Joseph said, hey, just remember me when you get out because I shouldn't be in here. But unfortunately, the butler completely forgot about it, and it wasn't until about 2 years later that Pharaoh had a dream. And he did not know the meaning, called in the wise men, they couldn't tell him. And it was then that the butler suddenly remembered, oh yes, I remember that fellow in prison. So he told Pharaoh about it, and so Pharaoh said, well, bring him here. And so Joseph was brought in, and Pharaoh told him the dream. He said, I dreamed that there were seven fat cows came up out of the River Nile, and they grazed there. And then seven thin cows, so thin you couldn't believe it, came up, and they gobbled up the seven fat cows. Well, Joseph said, I'll tell you what that means. It means that there's going to be 7 years of plenty, and that will be followed by 7 years of famine. The Nile is going to stop flowing just about, and there'll be a famine. So you better gather together, appoint somebody to gather together all the grain during those 7 years of plenty, so that when the 7 years of famine comes, you'll have enough to eat. And so Pharaoh said, well, that's a good idea, and what better person could we have to do all this than Joseph? And so Joseph was appointed as the vizier of Egypt. Now the question is, who was this Pharaoh? Which one? I personally consider that the chronology of Egypt needs to be shortened, and in that case, this incident would take place at the beginning of the 12th dynasty of Egypt. And in particular, the pharaoh concerned would be the pharaoh called Sesostris I. And I think I have some good reasons for thinking that. This is a statue of Sesostris I. Actually, he's quite a nice-looking guy, don't you think? Almost a smile on his face. And there's another group of statues in the Cairo Museum. They're clustered around a shrine. There's 10 statues altogether, and they're all identical, and they show him also as a nice-looking fellow. And there's another statue that shows him as a shepherd with a shepherd's crook in his hand. In other words, he was looking after his people. He had an interest in his people. Now, he was the one who made this obelisk over here, and it has inscriptions on all four sides. They're all identical. And this was the first large obelisk that was ever made. Now, it is called the Pillar of On. And the biblical record says that Joseph married the daughter of the priest of On. And that fits right in this place here. And so I would identify Sesostris I as the pharaoh under whom Joseph was promoted to be vizier. Now there is something else. The biblical record indicates that Joseph was a very prominent figure. I'd like you to listen to what the biblical record says in the book of Genesis. Chapter 41. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "You shall be over my house, and all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you." And he had him ride in the second chariot which he had, and they cried out before him, "Bow the knee." So he set him over all the land of Egypt. Now, did you notice just what respect was paid to Joseph? People bowed down in front of him. Now, that didn't usually happen with a vizier. But it so happens that under Sesostris I, we know from history that there was such a vizier, and his name was Mentuhotep. The very well-known Egyptologist Brugsch described the activities of this vizier. I want you to listen to what it says. In a word, our Mentuhotep, who was also invested with several priestly dignities and was Pharaoh's treasurer, appears as the alter ego of the king. When he arrived, the great personages bowed down before him. So you see, this fits in very well with the biblical account, and we do have such a vizier under Sesostris I. But there's other evidence too to support what I'm saying. Well, here we are in the Fayyum, this remarkable oasis that supports so many people, and here I think is something very significant. You see this canal, it's a very large canal, and it comes a long way and flows into this oasis, which is below sea level, and enters a vast lake, and it brings fertility to this whole area. Now, the interesting part is that this is called Joseph's Canal, and nobody knows where it got that name. It seems to go back a long way. And it is my opinion that this canal, which was dug during the 12th dynasty, the early 12th dynasty, was dug during the time of Joseph, who knew that a seven-year famine was coming, and so he had this canal dug to provide fertility to the land of Egypt during this time. Now, there's something else I think is very significant, and that is further downstream is a place called Beni Hassan. And at Beni Hassan, there are some tombs. And one of these tombs has on the wall a beautiful painting, well, it used to be beautiful, it's faded now, of some Semitic immigrants who had come into Egypt. And there it shows the type of clothing they wore, the type of domestic animals they had, the type of weapons, and you'll even notice that this fellow had brought his portable TV with him. Well, actually, it's a musical instrument anyway. So this shows the Semitic immigrants during the 12th dynasty. Now, who were they? I don't say that they were Joseph and his family, but I do consider it highly likely that they were the Israelite people who had fanned out over the land, and this man thought it significant enough to put it on the wall of his tomb. Now, there is one more thing I want to tell you about. One of these tombs was made by a man by the name of Amini, and he also was during the time of Sesostris I. And he left on the wall of his tomb a record of his good deeds. That's what they mostly did, you know, told the gods what a good fellow they were. And among other things, he referred to what he did to prepare for a coming famine. Now, Jan will read you a statement from a historian and a translation of this wall inscription.
"No one was unhappy in my days, not even in the years of famine, for I had tilled all the fields of the Nome of Mar up to its southern and northern frontiers. Thus I prolonged the life of its inhabitants and preserved the food which it produced."
And so I consider all of this points to the fact that Sesostris I was the pharaoh under whom Joseph was the vizier of Egypt. Now we come to the fifth king of the 12th dynasty, whose name was Sesostris III. And I consider him to be the pharaoh referred to in the book of Exodus chapter 1 and in verse 8, where it says, "Now there arose a new king over Egypt who did not know Joseph. And he said to his people, 'Look, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come, let us deal wisely with them.' Therefore they set taskmasters over them to afflict them."
Well, I consider that by now Joseph would be dead, and this would be the Pharaoh referred to in this verse. And believe me, he's a nasty-looking character, just the sort of fellow you would expect to do this sort of thing. For instance, there is this statue of him in the Cairo Museum. Do you notice the downturned, sour mouth that he's got and the nasty expression? And then here's another statue of him, a similar appearance. And then here is this sphinx of him. I just wouldn't like to know this fellow. And I think he's the pharaoh referred to here. Sesostris III was followed by Amenemhet III. And he also was a nasty-looking character, as his statues indicate. Here's one, for instance, in the Luxor Museum. And he reigned for 43 years. This is his pyramid that he built here. Not a very big pyramid today, but originally it was covered with stone and a lot bigger than this. Today, all that is left is the core of the pyramid, which is made of mud bricks that are laced with straw. In fact, you can see the little flecks of straw that were in there. And after all, that's what we would expect, isn't it? Because here in Exodus chapter 5 and in verse 7 it says, "You shall no longer give the people straw to make brick as heretofore. Let them go and gather straw for themselves." So I think that this was the pharaoh who was responsible for this. Another interesting point is that Amenemhet III had a daughter, no sons. And that daughter had no children. Her name was Sebek-Nefru-Rey. And this would explain why she went down to the River Nile and saw the little baby Moses in a basket there. You might wonder, well now, why would an Egyptian princess take a little baby from the slaves and propose to make him the next pharaoh? Well, you see, she wasn't down there having a bath or taking a swim. She was down there for ceremonial purposes, worshipping the god Harpy, the river god, the Nile god, and he was the fertility god. And of course, she'd need a god like that if she was infertile. And so she was down there worshipping the god Harpy, the fertility god. All right, and so she sees this little baby comes along and regards it as a gift of the fertility god Harpy. And I think probably she called him Harpy Moses. You see, Moses means drawn out of, or born of. In other words, born of the river god Harpy. There are a number of pharaohs called that. For instance, there was Tutmosis, born of the god Tut. There was Ramoses, or Ramesses, born of the god Ra. So here we have Moses, born of the god Harpy. Well, he was the baby who was to become the next pharaoh. But he disappears off the scene. And it's not hard to understand why. There was a king by the name of Amenemhet IV who was intended to be the heir of Amenemhet III. But suddenly he disappears from the scene. I think that was Moses myself, because he was forced to flee at the end of this man's reign. And so we come to the end of this dynasty, and I think it fits in very well with what we know of the biblical history. Well, now we're visiting the tomb of Sesostris II. You see it over there in the distance? Also a mud brick pyramid. And this particular pyramid was made by Sesostris II, and it was excavated by Sir Flinders Petrie in the year 1891. And Rosalie David published a book only in 1986 in which she highlighted some of the discoveries made by Petrie. And he found that there was an entire city here which was occupied by Semitic slaves, if you please. We'll go to the top of the pyramid and I'll point out the city from there. Well, I don't want to have to climb that pyramid every hot summer day. But from here, you can look out and see where the temple was and where the city was that Petrie excavated. Now, he found evidence there that it had been occupied by the workmen who lived and who worked on building these pyramids. And he concluded from the evidence that they were Semitic slaves. Now, there's something else that he found too. This book by Egyptologist Rosalie David was only published in 1986, and it is on the people who built the pyramids, the actual workmen, you see.
It has in particular here a chapter called The Foreign Population at Kahun. And it says, from his excavations at Kahun, Petrie formed the opinion that a certain element of the population there had come from outside Egypt. Now, the archaeologists couldn't figure out who this foreign population were. It says here, it is apparent that the Asiatics, now an Asiatic is a term that the Egyptians used for somebody from Syria or Palestine or somewhere in that region, the Asiatics were present in the town in some numbers, and this may have reflected the situation elsewhere in Egypt. It can be stated that these people were loosely classed by Egyptians as Asiatics, although their exact homeland in Syria or Palestine cannot be determined. Now, the reason that they could not determine it is because I consider they have the wrong chronology. Therefore, they did not associate them with the Israelite slaves. I believe they should be identified as the Israelite slaves. It says the reason for their presence in Egypt remains unclear. In other words, we don't know who they were or how they came to be in Egypt. But put it with the biblical account and you have the answer. They were enslaved by the Pharaoh. Of particular interest, I think, is something that Petrie found under the floors there. There were boxes. Do you see the picture of the box here? Very well preserved. And this box was found under the floor, as boxes were under many of the floors of the homes. And it says, larger wooden boxes, probably used originally to store clothing and other possessions, were discovered underneath the floors of many houses at Kahun. They contained babies, sometimes buried two or three to a box and aged only a few months at death. I think that's very significant. How did they get there? Well, we know from the biblical record that Pharaoh decreed that all the baby boys were to be put to death at birth. Some of the mothers managed to look after their babies for a month or two or 3 months, as with Moses, but then I can see the Egyptians coming along, wrenching them from the arms of the Israelite mothers, killing them, and the loving parents burying them in these boxes under their floors. One more significant point about this is as to where all these Asiatic slaves went to. Interesting. Listen. There are different opinions of how this first period of occupation at Kahun drew to a close. The quantity, range, and type of articles of everyday use which were left behind in the houses may indeed suggest that the departure was sudden and unpremeditated. Now, how can slaves just suddenly pack up and leave? Just drop all everything and leave. And here's the evidence that this is what happened. It's unbelievable, unless you accept the biblical account, that all these Israelite slaves just suddenly left Egypt in the great Exodus movement. I read to you what the biblical account says in Exodus chapter 12 and in verse 41. It came to pass at the end of the 430 years, on that selfsame day, it came to pass that all the armies of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. Well, personally, I think that explains why the slaves left suddenly and unpremeditatively. Now, archaeologists say, generally, that there is no record in Egypt of the Exodus or of the Israelite slaves, for that matter. Well, I think that's because they were looking for it in the wrong place. They're looking for it at the end of the 18th or 19th dynasty, but if you look for it at the end of the 12th dynasty, I believe you do find a record. You see, these 10 plagues that fell on Egypt prior to the Exodus were absolutely devastating. Listen, Exodus 7, and all the waters that were in the river were turned to blood. The fish that were in the river died. The Egyptians could not drink the water of the river. Whether they actually turned to blood or looked like blood doesn't matter. The point is, they couldn't drink the water. Chapter 9, the hand of the Lord will be on your cattle, horses, donkeys, camels, oxen, sheep, a very severe pestilence. All the livestock of Egypt died. Well, you can see how Egypt is dependent upon its livestock, and if they all dropped dead, it must have been an absolute disaster. Then we read, Moses stretched out his hand toward heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail. The hail struck throughout the whole land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail struck every herb of the field and broke every tree of the field. All their fruit trees were devastated. And so it absolutely shattered the economy of Egypt. And the locusts went up over all the land of Egypt and rested on all the territory of Egypt. They were very severe. And they covered the face of the whole earth so that the land was darkened. They ate every herb of the land and all the fruit of the trees which the hail had left. Here you've got beautiful crops here, but they're all destroyed by locusts, hail, thunder, everything.
and Egypt was absolutely laid in the dust. Well, there should have been some record of all this in Egypt if it really happened, and I believe there is a record if you look in the right place. In the Leiden Museum in Holland, there is a papyrus there called the Ipuwer Papyrus, and it's to be dated to this time. Now you listen, Jan's going to read you a translation of it.
Plague stalketh through the land and blood is everywhere. Nay, but many dead men are buried in the river. Nay, but the river is blood. Does a man drink thereof? He rejects it as a human. Nay, but gates, columns and walls are consumed with fire. Nay, but corn has perished everywhere. The storehouse is bare.
So, you see, when we look in the right place, we find that you can take the biblical record seriously and it all fits into place.
In our next program, we leave the pyramids of Egypt and travel south to the tombs and temples of Luxor and Karnak. There we will further investigate how biblical history can be both complemented and brought alive by historical facts and archaeological discoveries. Luxor was the capital of Egypt during the reign of King Tutankhamun, and in the rugged hills of the West Bank lies the famed Valley of the Kings, whilst to the east, the beautiful temples of Luxor and Karnak. Welcome to Luxor, where we continue our story of ancient Egypt. In our last program, we showed you the mighty monuments of the Pyramid Age. So let's just first refresh our memory as to how it all ended. Firstly, there was the destruction of Egypt's farms and flocks by the 10 devastating plagues. Then the annihilation of the Egyptian army in the waters of the Red Sea in the Exodus. And finally, the collapse of power of the 12th dynasty. Egypt was then occupied by the mysterious Hyksos, who were later driven out of Egypt, and the kings of the 18th dynasty ushered in a glorious era of prosperity and power.
It was probably Sekinen Re of the 17th dynasty who started the war of liberation against the Hyksos. And how it all started is really rather ludicrous. You wouldn't believe it. A delegation came from the Hyksos king way down there in the delta, some 700 kilometres away. And this delegation came up here to Luxor and said, look, you are digging a canal and there are hippopotami in this canal. And their grunting at night is keeping the Hyksos king awake. Well, Sekinen Re had to do something about it, and so he politely said, all right, I'll do something. But after they went, I can just see him turning to his courtiers and saying, listen, you fellas, I've had it. That's the last straw. I'm going to drive these fellas out of the land of Egypt. And so the War of Liberation started. Well, Sekinen Re was not successful. In fact, if you look at his mummy in the Cairo Museum, you find that it has two savage gashes in the forehead, and archaeologists have fitted a battle axe blade in there, and they find that it just fits perfectly. Apparently he died of a battle axe wound in this war of liberation. But he was succeeded by his son, Karmosis, and by his brother, Ahamosis. And between them, they successfully drove the Hyksos out of Egypt and off the pages of history. Well, they were followed by Amenophis I and then Thutmose I. Well, Thutmose I started something new. You see, up until this time, all the previous kings had been buried in pyramids. But apparently Thutmose I decided there was no future in that. They were being robbed and plundered anyway. And so he started a new idea. It's away over there on the other side of the River Nile. And it's called the Valley of the Kings, where this idea started. Oh, this is just beautiful. I love this scenery. I'm walking along 6 o'clock in the morning along the bank of the Nile here at Luxor. The reeds are floating down the river. Over there, see those hills? Well, over there is the Valley of the Kings. And that's where Thutmose I started this new burial fashion. We're going to go over in a ferry and finish up in the Valley of the Kings, right over there. Here we are looking down on the Valley of the Kings, and instead of building a pyramid for his burial place, Thutmose had his workmen chisel a hole into the side of the valley, and there at the end of the passage he had a tomb chamber. Now, he was followed by other kings who did the same thing, and some of these tomb passages go 100 meters into the side of the cliff, and there are some beautiful paintings on the walls. Of the passage was a tomb chamber in which was a sarcophagus in which the king's mummy was buried. Well, Thutmose I was responsible for this obelisk that you see behind me here, and it stands over 21 meters high. And if we are to accept the revised chronology of Dr. Emmanuel Velikovsky, it's rather interesting to notice that Thutmose I would be contemporary with King Solomon of Israel. All right, if that is the case, then this passage we find here in 1 Kings 3:1 is applicable. It says, "Now Solomon made a treaty with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and married Pharaoh's daughter." And so Solomon would have been the son-in-law of Thutmose I. Now, this Pharaoh gave his daughter a very unusual dowry for her wedding. You'll never guess what it was. But I'm going to read to you from 1 Kings chapter 9 and in verse 16, where it says, "Pharaoh, king of Egypt, had gone up and taken Gezer and burned it with fire, had killed the Canaanites who dwelt in the city, and had given it as a dowry to his daughter, Solomon's wife." Well, now, if what I'm saying is correct, we should be able to find some evidence of Gezer being burned with fire. Let us have a look at the city of Gezer and the excavations there. It was built on this hill, and over the other side, the archaeologists have done some excavating. They have carved a deep trench which exposes the strata or layers of occupation. I went there and had a good look at these strata, and I found that there was a layer of ash there. Very heavy ash, in fact. I brought back some of the grains of wheat
that had been burnt and carbonized. You can still distinctly see the little grains of wheat. So Giza was thoroughly burned. All right, then, who did it? I took some pottery from underneath this burnt stratum, and I showed it to one of Israel's top archaeologists for identification. He without hesitation said, "This comes from the early Bronze period." Now, that means, in my thinking, that this was the Canaanite occupation, and above it was the Middle Bronze, which I consider to be the Israelite occupation. So here we have the evidence at Gezer that the Canaanites were conquered at some time, their city was burned, and above it is the evidence of Israelite occupation. When Thutmose I died, he was succeeded by his son, Thutmose II. But this poor guy didn't last very long, only for another 4 years, and then he seems to have dropped dead. Well, he had no successor except his son by another wife, who was Thutmose III. But he was only a boy, he was only a child at the time. And so the wife of Thutmose II assumed the throne. Her name was Queen Hatshepsut, whose statue you see here. And Hatshepsut reigned for 21 peaceful and prosperous years. Well, she seems to have liked the job because she started off as a regent, but then this statue depicts her with a queen's attire, female attire. Now, this statue here depicts her as having male attire. Do you see that? In other words, she was assuming the role not of a queen now, but of a king, a pharaoh. And she took all the titles of a pharaoh. And her statues in the Cairo Museum actually depict her as wearing a beard. For instance, this statue and then this sphinx of her shows her with a beard. Now, you might say that's ridiculous, a woman wearing a beard. But you see, the pharaohs themselves were clean-shaven, and they simply stuck a beard on their chins for ceremonial occasion, and I suppose Hatshepsut figured if the men can do it, she can do it too. Anyway, that's what she did. Well, Hatshepsut built some tremendous obelisks. This one lying here is the biggest one in the land of Egypt at the present time. It snapped in half, actually. And this other one that is standing over here is the largest standing obelisk in the land of Egypt, in contrast to her father's, Thutmose, over there. Her obelisk is more than 30 meters high. She was also responsible for a magnificent mortuary temple. Well, Western people today are buried in holes in the ground like that, and then they put a tombstone on top. Well, this is Hatshepsut's tombstone, and you call it a beautiful mortuary temple. And I consider that she should be identified with the Queen of Sheba. You see, it says in 1 Kings chapter 10 and in verse 1, "Now when the Queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to test him with hard questions." Well, who was this Queen of Sheba? I don't think we should be in any doubt myself, because Jesus Christ identifies her in Matthew 12 and in verse 42. He says, "Now when the Queen of the South came to hear the wisdom of Solomon," she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. He calls her the Queen of the South. Well, in Daniel chapter 11, we have the King of the North and the King of the South. And there, the King of the South is identified as the King of Egypt. And so if the King of the South is the King of Egypt, well then surely the Queen of the South must be the Queen of Egypt. And that is what Josephus, the ancient historian, says. He identifies her as the Queen of Egypt and Ethiopia. Here is Hatshepsut's mother, and she's seated on the birth stool, and the baby will be placed here. And she depicts herself as being born in the presence of the gods. Here is the god Tot, here is the god Amun, and here was the baby being received by the gods. This was to establish her claim to the throne. This scene shows Hatshepsut's expedition to the land of Punt. You can see her soldiers with their shields standing on the deck of the ship, see the fish underneath, and they're going on this expedition to God's land. Here are her sailors pulling on the oars. You see the ship there? and the last, they're on the way to the land of Punch. Now, up here are some trees and plants that this expedition brought back from the land of Punt. The archaeologists didn't know where the land of Punt was, and so they called on the botanists and said, "Listen, you fellows, can you tell us where these plants come from?" And the botanist said, "Sure, we can tell you. They come from East Africa, maybe Somalia or Eritrea." And so the archaeologist said, "Fine, now we know where the land of Punt is. But I think there's another explanation. Look at it this way. In 1 Kings chapter 10, and in verse 10 it says, "Then she," that is the Queen of Sheba, "gave the king 120 talents of gold, spices in precious great abundance, precious stones, also the ships, and King Solomon gave the Queen of Sheba all she desired. Also the ships of Hiram brought gold from Ophir, and great quantities of almug wood, or trees, and precious stones from Ophir." Now you see, they actually brought these things from East Africa, and when the Queen of Sheba came there, she said, "Yeah, I want some of them." And so they brought them back, and I think that's why they finished up on this wall. There was something else that impressed the Queen of Sheba in her visit to Solomon. It says, "And when the Queen of Sheba had seen all the wisdom of Solomon, the house that he had built," that's his temple, "and his entryway," or his ascent, "by which he went up to the house of the Lord, there was no more spirit in her." You see, there was something about the way he went up to the temple that impressed her. And when you look at this, it seems to me that she came back and said to her workmen, "Now look, I want a temple built like that." This is unique, you see. There was never anything like this before in the land of Egypt. Now, it is true that most archaeologists identify Sheba with a city in southwest Arabia by the name of Mareb. But for this, there is no inscriptional evidence to support it. Wendell Phillips, an American archaeologist, conducted an excavation there, very exciting really, and he wrote a book called Sheba's Buried City. Wonderful book, but there's no evidence to support this view that the Queen of Sheba came from southwest Arabia.
But suddenly, Queen Hatshepsut disappears from the scene, and we suspect that her son-in-law, Thutmose III, whose relief is seen here, knew something about it. Because immediately we find him going round the land of Egypt, demolishing her statues and erasing her name from her inscriptions.
Here was a relief of Hatshepsut seated upon her throne with her scepter in her hand. But Thutmose sent his workmen round here, and see how they've chiseled it all off. This was part of his rage to show his anger at being held back from the throne so long.
So he became the mightiest of all the pharaohs. He conducted no less than 17 military campaigns, very successful. And he left some very fine statues of himself.
For instance, there is this statue in the Luxor Museum and this very fine statue in the New York Museum.
Thutmose was also responsible for this great festal hall here at Karnak, in which the archaeologists found a very important king list. He was also responsible for erecting four big obelisks. He depicts two of them on his wall over there. One of them has since gone to the city of London and stands on the Thames Embankment. Another has gone to New York. Another one has gone to Istanbul. And the biggest of them all stands in front of the Church of St. John Lateran in Rome. It's 32.2 metres high and weighs 455 tonnes. It's an enormous thing, the biggest obelisk that was ever made in the land of Egypt. Thutmose III, whose relief you see here, left this record of his military campaigns. And he records here over 100 cities, each one depicted by this oval with the form on top, cities which he conquered in Palestine and Syria. At the top of this list, there is the city of Kadesh. Now, the word Kadesh means holy or holy city, and this could refer to Jerusalem. Now, if what we're saying is correct, this then is a record of the Bible story of Rehoboam being invaded by the Pharaoh of Egypt. And it says here in 1 Kings 14 and verse 25, "Now it happened in the fifth year of the king Rehoboam that Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem, and he took away the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house. He took everything away. He also took away the gold shields which Solomon had made." Now, Thutmose not only left a record of the cities he conquered, but he left a record of the loot that he took. And I want to show you that. It was on this wall that Thutmose depicted a list of all the loot that he took from his military campaign. Dr. Emmanuel Velikovsky, who is of Jewish origin, has made a comparison between what was in Solomon's temple, according to the record of the Book of Chronicles, and the items that are listed here, and he claims there's a very close similarity between those. For instance, you will notice up here the fire pans and the bowls, the dishes. There's something up here that looks very much like the Ark of the Covenant with the poles through it by which the priests carried it. And there is an altar. It looks like a fire altar, such as would be expected from the temple in Jerusalem. And then there is this other altar up here. Well, it looks more like seven lampstands. That sounds a bit familiar. In particular, look up there. There are two doors. Do you see that? And they're golden doors. And it says in 1 Kings chapter 6 and in verse 32, the two doors were of olive wood, and he carved on them figures of cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers, and overlaid them with gold. Golden doors. And so we have golden doors up here. Pharaoh Shishonk was the founder of the Libyan 22nd dynasty. And just around the corner here, he has left a relief which shows a list of cities that were in Palestine and Syria, and authorities have identified this list with the cities conquered by Shishak of the Bible. The list is somewhat similar, as you can see, these ovals with the heads on top, similar to the list that was left by Thutmose III. But I don't consider this to be a valid identification. If this really was the Shishak of the Bible, what city would you expect to find at the top of the list? Well, Jerusalem, of course. But Jerusalem is not even in this list. Moreover, authorities consider that this is not a historical list, for some of the cities mentioned here had ceased to exist by the time of Shishak. The Mitanni, in particular, had been wiped out 400 years prior to this list. So I don't consider this to be a valid identification. Thutmose III had transformed Egypt from a nation into an empire by his military conquests. And from then on, the tribute flowed in from the surrounding nations, enabling the pharaohs of the 18th and 19th dynasty to build such massive temples and monuments. He was followed by Amenophis II, or Amenhotep II. And he left a rather interesting statue, which is today in the Cairo Museum, and it depicts him as a devotee of the cow goddess Hathor. Up the front end, you see him under the protection of the cow goddess, and at the other end, well, he's drawing nourishment hot off the grid from this deity. After Amenophis II came Thutmose IV. And he has left rather an interesting stele between the paws of the Sphinx. He records there how he was to become the pharaoh as the result of a dream he had in which the Sphinx appeared to him and said, "If you'll only clear the sand that is stifling me, I'll make you the next pharaoh." Now, some people have read a lot into this and tried to make out that he was made the pharaoh as the result of this dream. Well, I don't consider that to be plausible. It was simply a device the pharaohs had to claim the throne as a divine right. And so he simply claims that the Sphinx appeared to him and spoke to him. Well, he was followed by Amenophis III, sometimes referred to as Amenophis or Amenhotep the Magnificent because of his tremendous building program. And the largest statue in the Cairo Museum depicts Amenophis III and his wife with her arm affectionately round his waist. The magnitude of his building projects can be gauged from these two colossal statues of Amenophis III, which once stood at the entrance of his great temple here at Luxor. some idea of the enormous magnitude of this temple. Do you see that stele away back there? Well, that marked the rear end of the temple, which stretched right forward to those two huge statues known as the Colossi of Memnon, which marked the front of the temple. Around the other side of this statue of Amenophis is a small statue of his mother, Mutamwa. And on this side is a statue of his wife, Ti. Now, she's a bit cut down to size, of course, but anyway, he was apparently very devoted to her because she appears in so many statues, and it's a little difficult to understand why. If we go by a statue of her in the Berlin Museum, she is not exactly beautiful. But anyway, maybe she had a nice personality or something like that. Now, round the side of this statue, there is a very interesting symbolism. Can you see here two figures? And they're both of the river god Harpy, representing Upper and Lower Egypt. And do you notice how they're sort of tying something together? Well, after all, that's what the River Egypt does. It binds Upper and Lower Egypt together. And so this is a very fitting symbolism of the unity of Egypt, which the pharaohs tried to attain, and the river god Harpy binding Upper and Lower Egypt together. Now we come to a really intriguing era of Egyptian history. Following Amenophis III came his son, Amenophis IV. And this character adopted a new form of religion. He began to worship the sun god under the form of the god Aton, the sun disk. And he changed his name from Amenophis, which included the name of the god Amen, to Akhenaton, which incorporated the sun disk Aton. And his reliefs show him as worshipping this sun god. For instance, in this relief, which is in the Cairo Museum, we see him standing with hands upraised, worshipping Aton. And Aton, on the other hand, is reaching down its arms in extended blessing with hands outstretched upon the pharaoh and his wife. Now, Akhenaton was a grotesque figure, if we're going to go by his statues. Thick lips, thin cheeks, protruding belly, thick thighs. Did he really look like this, or was it a new art form? There's a lot of advocates of the latter theory, actually, but personally, I don't think anyone would want to be depicted like this unless he was really like this. It is true that the other members of his court also adopted a similar art form, but I think that was just following the fashion. Anyway, Akhenaton had some strange statues of himself. For instance, there's this one that shows him without any clothing on. Well, now, this was abnormal for a pharaoh. They were always modestly dressed. And this has given rise to a lot of speculation just why this should be. Was it because he was like this? Actually, you'll notice that something else is missing too. And this has led to suggestions that he was not able to procreate. But we do know that he had six daughters. You might say they were adopted. But if the pharaoh was going to adopt any children, you tell me, what would they be? Well, of course, they'd be sons. So it's quite apparent that he was able to procreate. Well, his beautiful wife, Nefertiti, has her statue made, and this head of her is in the Berlin Museum. It's a beautiful statue. I went to Berlin just purely and simply to see this statue, and I wasn't disappointed. And the extraordinary part is that it depicts her as blind in the left eye. Do you see that? Now, this has led to a lot of speculation too. Was she really blind, or didn't the artist finish his work? Or was the statue mutilated afterwards? Well, personally, I think that she did become blind in the left eye. And that would explain why she had a separate palace built for herself. Apparently, Akhenaton still loved her, but maybe he didn't want her as the retaining queen. And so, not wishing to banish her and yet not wishing to retain her, he built this separate palace for her down the other end of the new city that he'd built, Akhetaton, halfway between Memphis and Thebes. Now, Akhenaton apparently went through a very strange phase towards the end of his reign. And I think that is the reason that he is depicted in that statue that I showed you.
Perhaps even, as some have suggested, he developed homosexual qualities. Whatever it was, his was an extraordinary reign and a strange era in Egyptian history. Akhenaten was followed by his younger brother, Tutankhaten, and he reverted to the religion of Amun, and so changed his name to Tutankhamun. In 1922, Howard Carter made the spectacular discovery of Tutankhamun's tomb. It's way down there in the valley, and later on in this series, we're going to have a full program on Tutankhamun. You want to stay around for that, it's exciting. Tutankhamun was succeeded by I, and then by Haremheb, who went round the land of Egypt smashing all the statues of Akhenaten and demolishing all his temples. So this is where the archaeologists have stacked the stones from Akhenaten's smashed temple. And from the beautiful reliefs, you can see what a magnificent temple it was. This is the way the 18th dynasty came to its end. Ramesses I is usually considered to be the first king of the 19th dynasty, and he was followed by Seti I, and then came Ramesses II, or Ramesses the Great. And Seti and Ramesses II were responsible for this huge hypostyle hall, 134 massive columns in this great hypostyle hall. Ramesses was really great because he was a compulsive builder, and he also fought the famous Battle of Kadesh, depicted on his reliefs. He was often rejoiced to be able to tell about the Battle of Kadesh. And if you still don't think Ramesses was great, just consider this. He had 92 sons and 106 daughters. And if that doesn't make a man great, you tell me what does. Well, Ramesses also was responsible for the magnificent temple of Abu Simbel. Also, he depicts his battle against the Hittites at Kadesh, and we will have more to say about them in our next program. But Ramesses also made provision for his death. This is the Ramesseum, which is his mortuary temple, still in remarkably good condition. Even the roof is intact. And lying on the ground, you can see a statue of Ramesses, which is the biggest statue in the land of Egypt. You can get an idea of the enormous size of this statue by just looking at the feet. Well, Ramesses the Great died, of course. He ruled for 67 years. And that is his mortuary temple away over there in the distance. And he was succeeded by his son, Meneptah. Now, Meneptah left a stele, which is very important, just for one word that occurs on it, the word Israel. It's the only place in all the land of Egypt that the word Israel occurs. Now, Meneptah is not saying that he conquered Israel. He's simply recording a historical fact. He says, Israel is destroyed, her seed is no more. And personally, I consider this refers to the Assyrian invasion of Palestine and the exile of the 10 tribes of Israel into Assyria. We are at Medinet Habu, a temple of Ramesses III. And in this relief that you see here on the wall, Ramesses has his club lifted and he's about to bash somebody's brains out. And he is depicting here his battle with what are referred to as the peoples of the sea. Now, this battle is supposed to have occurred around 1200 BC. But there's some awkward anachronisms involved here by this present dating. One is, for instance,
that Ramesses III is supposed to be repelling these peoples of the sea who swept over Anatolia around 1200 BC and annihilated the Hittites. But we have a relief of Shalmaneser III in his obelisk, in which he refers to his battle with the Hittites. So here you are in the 9th century BC, and here's Shalmaneser fighting the Hittites, who are supposed to have been extinguished 1200 BC. You see, it just doesn't fit. And then too, in this gateway over here, there is obvious Assyrian influence. And you've got to date that to either the 8th or the 9th century BC. So where did Ramesses III get this concept from? Well, you can't say that he anticipated Assyrian influence. It is much easier to say that Ramesses III was a later date. And that's where I think it should be. In other words, what he is depicting here is his conflicts with the Assyrians. And that would put it around the 8th century BC. There's just one more thing that's rather interesting. Ramesses III has a palace, or had a palace, down in the delta at a place called Tel Yehuda. Now, some tiles were found there, if you please, and they also showed Persian influence, by the way. But on the back of the tiles, there were some Greek letters. Now, these Greek letters were intended so that they could put them all in the right place, you see. But the problem is, the Greek alphabet was not invented until 800 BC. And yet here is Ramesses supposed to be making these tiles 1200 BC. So I think all the evidence really points to the fact that this is Ramesses III fighting a battle with the Assyrians around about the 8th century BC. And as far as the sea peoples who are involved, well, the Assyrians simply conscripted the Phoenician navy and used them in their battles against the Egyptians. Well, we're just about down to the end of the history of ancient Egypt. We come down to the time of Pharaoh Hofra. He's mentioned in the biblical account in Jeremiah chapter 44 and in verse 30, where it says, "Behold, I'll give Pharaoh Hofra, king of Egypt, into the hand of his enemies." Hofra is to be identified with Pharaoh Apres. And this pharaoh left rather a cute sort of an obelisk that is today perched on the back of an elephant outside the Pantheon in Rome. The prophets of Israel were beginning to predict the doom of Egypt. Ezekiel 30 and verse 13 says, "I will also destroy the idols and cause the images to cease from Noph. There shall no longer be princes from the land of Egypt." That's exactly what happened. The Persian invasion came in the 4th century BC, and Cambyses smashed this statue of Ramesses the Great here in Luxor. The great conqueror Alexander the Great came here, 332 BC, and this relief shows him worshipping the god Amun. In the latter centuries came the Romans. Here, for instance, is Diocletian's pillar down there at Alexandria, sometimes referred to as Pompey's pillar. In the 7th century came the Islamic invasion, and finally we come down to the present state of the United Arab Republic of Egypt. And right down to the present time, there has never been a native prince in the land of Egypt over the last more than 2,000 years, and the idols have been smashed, everything is just as the Bible says. So it seems the Bible knew what it was talking about.
What makes Egypt so exciting, I believe, is its ability to take you back in time to the glories of its long-lost past empire. An empire that was once nearly lost to the powerful Hittites. To find out more about this relief of Ramesses the Great fighting the Hittites, we take you in our next program to Turkey. There we'll be visiting the weird and wonderful world of Cappadocia, with its incredible underground cities and geological formations. Although they nearly succeeded in defeating the Egyptians, the Hittites were lost from history for thousands of years. The scholars even denied their very existence, until recently, that is. Don't miss this next exciting episode of Digging Up the Past, when David reveals the dramatic story of how the Hittites were found once again. I suspect that, like me, most of you have never been to the moon, and we probably never shall. But the next best place to visit is an area called Cappadocia in Turkey, and that's where we're going next, for it's the land of the lost empire of the Hittites.
These fairy chimneys, as they are called, with their hats set at all sorts of rakish angles. You just really wonder how the creator thought this one up, wouldn't you? Of course, you can tell me it's a natural phenomenon, and it really is. Actually, this was some soft stone that was laid all over this area, and then on top of that came a layer of lava, you know, a volcanic layer spread out all over here. And as the harder lava cracked and got worn away, then of course what was not covered by lava was also worn away. But where the lava still stood, then of course it was protected. And so here we have these fairy chimneys. During the Christian era, there was a lot of persecution, and so many Christians settled in this area. Not that they escaped the persecution, but it attracted less attention, and so they were less harassed here. And they dug their houses out of the soft rock, out of these pinnacles. In fact, some people today still live in these houses that they dug, or build their own houses attached to them. I would say this is one of the better class houses. It is dug out of the cliff face, soft rock, easily cut into. You can see the pick marks where they have chiseled it out. And there are recesses where they could store food and other domestic items needed in the house. And there are niches where they could place their lamps to illuminate the inside of the house at night time. I'd say they live rather comfortably here. The Christians also carved their churches and chapels out of this soft rock and adorned the walls of them with very colourful frescoes. Many of the Christians went a step further and burrowed into the ground. They dug into the cliff face and then made just like a rabbit warren. They lived right underground. They burrowed down through this soft rock, their passages and staircases and housing rooms. You know, they went down eight stories down below the ground surface. And there were rooms and houses and places to live down here. You were at least close to your neighbours. No doubt this was great for the children, but what about the adults? They must have had a permanently bent back to be able to walk along these passages and feel at home. I suppose they were used to it. Of course, they lived here during the night and evening. Daytime, they went out and looked after their fields. Of course, they had to have some fresh air, even away down here, so they dug this shaft from the surface right down to the lowest story so that the fresh air could come down here and circulate through the passageways and into the rooms in which they were living. But I'm still not sure that this is where I would really like to live. This, then, is Hittite country. They occupied all of Cappadocia and Anatolia, in other words, what we'd call most of Turkey. And they're a very great nation. In fact, at one stage in ancient history, they were the greatest nation in the Middle East. And yet the extraordinary part is they were lost, forgotten. Scholars even denied their existence. It's interesting to look at the Encyclopaedia Britannica for the year 1861. And under the title Hittites, you know what? There's just 8.5 lines. And if you examine those 8.5 lines carefully, you'll find that it's purely and simply a summary of what the Bible says, just a brief summary of what the biblical record has to say about them. Well, actually, there's a lot in the Bible about the Hittites. As far as the Bible is concerned, they were never lost. 47 references in the Bible to the Hittites. Goes right back to the days of Abraham. In Genesis chapter 23, when his wife Sarah died, it says, "Then Abraham stood up from before his dead and spoke to the sons of Het," they're the Hittites, you see, "saying, 'Give me property for a burial place.'" And he purchased a place to bury his wife Sarah. And many references in respect to the Israelites coming into the Promised Land. For instance, in Genesis 7, verse 1, it says, "When the Lord your God brings you into the land which you go to possess and has cast out many nations before you, the Hittites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites." Now, there's 7 nations there, and you'll notice the Hittites are at the top of the list. And yet, the Amorites, the Canaanites, were very familiar with them, and they were very well-known and strong nations. Yet the Hittites are put at the top of the list. Now, there's another verse that should have caused the scholars to do a little deep thinking on, and that's in 2 Kings chapter 7 and in verse 6, where it says, referring to the Syrians besieging Samaria, and all of a sudden the besieging army packed up and fled. And what was the reason? Well, it tells us here, "For the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, the noise of a great army. So they said to one another, 'Look, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to attack us.'" Now, everyone knew that the Egyptians were very strong and powerful. But here it puts the Hittites ahead of the Egyptian army. Now, quite obviously, the Bible knew that they were a very powerful nation. And you've got these 47 references, and yet they were lost and forgotten for a long time. The story of their discovery is a very exciting one. It's one of these long, drawn-out dramas, and I want to tell you all about that. Our story really doesn't begin here in this village. It began in the city of Hamat in northern Syria in the year 1810, when John Burckhardt, the man who discovered Petra later on, was visiting there and he found built into a house some stones that had some strange writing on it. And he wrote later in his book called Travels in Syria of these stones, he said they were hieroglyphs, but they weren't Egyptian hieroglyphs. But of course he didn't know who was responsible for this strange writing, and he simply recorded it. Now the scholars should have picked it up, but I suppose there were so many other exciting things in his book, they just didn't notice this. So the next thing was in the year 1834, when Charles Texier was travelling through Turkey, and he was looking for a lost city, the lost city of Tavium, a Roman city. And he would go from village to village, town to town, and he would say, are there any ruins here? And he'd go and look at them to try and identify them as Tavium, you see. Well, when he came here, he asked his usual question, are there any ruins around here? And they said, yeah, sure, there are ruins here. There's plenty up on the hill. So up on the hill he went. What Texier saw here really made him gasp. There was this King's Gate, as it is called. It was partially buried in his day, of course. But in the front of it here, there is a figure that they thought was the king. Really looks like a prize fighter, you know, doesn't he? Actually, one of the Hittite gods. This is not the original. The original is in the museum. This one is simply a plaster cast, and it's rather badly worn. When I first came here, it was in very good condition. And then Texier went up on the wall, and what he saw there made him even more amazed. When Texier got up here, he could look along the wall and trace it going right up the hill there. You can see it at the top of the hill, partially reconstructed up there. And following it round, he found that altogether it was about 5 kilometres in circumference. Well, this certainly wasn't Tavium. It was far too big for that. But what was it? The locals couldn't tell him, and he didn't have a clue. So what was this place? The following year, 1835, a British explorer by the name of William Hamilton came on the scene, and he stumbled across a place called Alachahoyuk. This is the entrance to Alachahoyuk, and these sphinxes on the side here are very well carved, and these were obvious to William Hamilton when he first came here. There's one each side of this gateway. He couldn't identify them, he didn't know who was responsible for them, and he simply recorded them. Then in the year 1862, George Perrow came across this place. It's called the Nishan Tash. And here were some strange hieroglyphic characters, which again were similar to the ones on the Hamat stones. And of course he couldn't identify who was responsible for these hieroglyphs, but he recorded them. And then in the year 1870, two American explorers by the name of Johnson and Jessop also visited Hamat and recorded their visit and noted the Hamat stones with the hieroglyphics on them. But then in the year 1872, a man of a totally different character came on the scene. And he was William Wright, who was an Irish missionary in Hamat. Now, he spoke the language. He understood the Arabs and the Turks, and he saw these stones and recognised their value. And what was more important, he was on very friendly terms with the Turkish governor, Subi Pasha. And so he went to the governor and said, look, it would be in the interest of the Turkish government to have these stones removed and sent off to the museum. And so Subi Pasha, being an enlightened man, agreed to that. And so next day he sent his soldiers along to start chiselling the stones out of the wall. And that is where the trouble started, because the locals regarded these not only as important stones in the building itself, and they didn't want the building spoiled, but they also had a superstition that these stones had magical qualities, especially for eye diseases, of which there was no shortage at that time. And so they violently objected.
However, the army was on the governor's side and they took the stones, took them back to the palace. Well, that night, whirling dervishes raced through the streets, stirring up the passions of the crowd, and they tried to storm the gates of the governor's palace. And William Wright, who was also there, was a little frightened inside. But the soldiers held out. Next morning, the governor received a delegation. And the delegation came in and stated their case. Now, what had made matters worse was during the night, there had been a fall of meteorites. And these falling stars that really aroused the superstitions of the people. And so the delegation came in and the governor listened to them. And finally, after their protests, he said, now let me see, did these falling stars do any kill anyone? And they said, no. And he said, did they kill any cattle or sheep? No. And he said, did they damage any buildings? No. Ah, said the governor, then what better evidence do we have of Allah's good pleasure on what we have done? And with that choice bit of Eastern logic, the whole delegation came to an end. And the Haymat stones were removed to the Constantinople Museum, where they are today. In 1876, excavations were conducted at Carchemish. Now that's a way down, a long way from here in northern Syria. And in these excavations, these strange artifacts belonging to the same people started turning up. It was quite apparent that whoever it was had an empire extending right down as far as northern Syria. And during the next few years, artifacts were turning up all over Turkey, and the scholars were embarrassed because the public were asking them, listen, you fellows, this was a great empire, and you don't know who it was. Then in 1880, the archaeological bombshell burst. Archibald Henry Sayce announced to an august gathering of scholars in London his conclusion that all these artifacts, all these evidences, should be attributed to none other than the biblical Hittites. Well, the scholars went off into peals of laughter. They said, Sayce, you're mad. They dubbed him the inventor of the Hittites. But the facts were accumulating. And in 1881, the Encyclopaedia Britannica once more came out. This time, not 8.5 lines, but 2 whole pages. And down at the bottom of the article, there was this statement. We wait longingly for a confirmation of Professor Sayce's view that the Hittites were the authors of the Hamathite hieroglyphics. If this be proved, this wonderful nation steps into a position hardly surpassed by that of any of the nations of the distant East. Well, it was a prophetic statement that really came true. And during the next few years, more and more information came in. And in 1884, our friend William Wright published a book called The Empire of the Hittites, in which he produced so much information and evidence that the scholars just had to back down and admit that Sayce was right and that these people were the biblical Hittites. Then in 1887, there was a very interesting development. In that year, what are known as the Tel el Amarna letters were discovered, not here in Turkey, but away over there in Egypt. They were letters in the cuneiform script. At first, of course, the scholars said that they were forgeries because nobody expected cuneiform to be found in Egypt. But when they were read and understood, here were some letters that were found in the Assyrian cuneiform script, but in an unknown language, which scholars rightly concluded was the Hittite language. They were known as the Azawa letters, and scholars went to work on trying to decipher the Hittite language. There was a scholar in 1902 by the name of Knudsen who concluded and announced that the Hittite language was actually an Indo-European language. That also made the scholars laugh. Indo-European, why, it might be some other, it might be a Semitic language, or it might be Hamitic, but not Indo-European. And they produced so many arguments that poor Knudsen recanted and admitted that he had made a mistake. Time was to prove that Knudsen was correct.
In the year 1906, a very eccentric German came here who was totally unsuited to the harsh Middle East Turkish conditions, and he was not really an archaeologist, he was an epigraphist. That means he was an expert in inscriptions, and he was looking for tablets. And so he came to this place, Boghaz Kali, known to the Hittites as Hattusis, and his interest was to find tablets. And so he came to this acropolis or high place, the citadel, and started searching. Well, would you believe it? He started digging here and he found no less than 10,000 tablets. And most of them were in the cuneiform script, which he could read like you read your daily newspaper, and in the Assyrian language, which of course his language, he could very familiar with it. And so he was able to learn a lot about the Hittites. Well, he, night by night, he was a very hard-working man, and night by night, he'd, by the flickering light of his lamp, you know, he'd pick up a tablet and translate it, pick up a tablet. And one night, he picked up a tablet, and he could hardly believe what he saw there. He found himself reading the Hittite version of the peace treaty between Ramesses the Great and Hattusilus, the very one that was on the wall at Karnak and other places. And so here was the Hittite version of it. And so he was able to learn a lot about the Hittite history by reading these translations. In 1915, a scholar by the name of Hrozny confirmed that the Hittite language was indeed an Indo-European language. And from then on, there was no turning back. And in 1929, a manual of the Hittite language was published. In other words, the scholars could now not only read the Hittite history in Assyrian language, but also in the Hittite language. So, two problems had been solved. First of all, the identification of the Hittites. Secondly, to be able to read their language. But now, there was the third problem. And that was to be able to read their strange hieroglyphic characters. Actually, our friend Archibald William Sayce had made an attempt at this in 1880. He'd come across what was known as the Takandimos seal, and it was a bilingual, that is the same thing in two different languages or scripts. And he thought by comparing them he'd get a clue to reading the hieroglyphics. But it was not to be. It was only a seal. Didn't give him much information. In 1934, Kurt Bittell found here no less than 100 bilinguals, and the scholars thought, now we've got it made. All these bilinguals, that is the same message in two different scripts, one readable, the other the hieroglyphs, will be able to do it. But they're only seals. And they all said more or less the same thing. And so once more, they had the problem. And so the scholars had to work on this to try and find out how to unlock the Hittite hieroglyphs. The final breakthrough came from rather an unexpected quarter. There was a scholar by the name of Helmut Bosser, and he was attending a convention. At the same convention, there was a Turkish scholar. And the Turkish scholar said to him, "Say, why don't you come and teach at the Istanbul University for a while?" And so Bosser said, "Well, why not?" And so he finished up at the Istanbul University. Well, during the holiday period, Bosser decided to do some excavating, and he took a team down to a place called Karatepe. And there they did a season of excavations, found a lot of interesting things. On the last day, when everyone was packing up their tents and goods and chattels, Bosser just did a little wandering around on his own account, and he saw a stone protruding from the ground. He did a little scraping, and he was very excited to discover that it was a slab of stone on which there was a Phoenician inscription. And he thought, wouldn't it be fantastic if this was a bilingual, that is, a stone that tells the same thing in two different languages. And so he excavated another stone over here, and sure enough, there were some markings on it which he thought were Hittite hieroglyphics. He thought, we've got it. But do you know what he did? He just filled it all in, left it there, didn't say a word to anybody, just went back, packed up. Next morning they went back to the university. Well, I think Bossert was one of these people who had a sense of the dramatic. In the next season of excavations, they all came to the site and they started out the next morning. And Bossert said, well, now, where shall we start excavating today? Why don't we start over here? And so he put his men to work there, and sure enough, a few moments later, there were squeals of delight. They found this stone with the Phoenician inscription on it. And Bossier said, hey, wouldn't it be great if this was a bilingual? Look, dig over here. And so they dug over there, and sure enough, here was this stone with these markings on it. But as it came to the light of day, Bossier realized that what he thought had been Hittite hieroglyphs were nothing more than the cracks and weathering of time. Bossier's heart just sank right down to his boots. However, they continued with the excavations, and sure enough, they did find another stone, and it was a bilingual. It was in the Hittite hieroglyphs. And so, as a result of comparing these two stones together, they were able to unlock the meaning of the hieroglyphs. And so, in 1954, a manual of a dictionary of Hittite hieroglyphs was published, and this opened a vast world of knowledge about the Hittites to the scholars and about the Hittite history. In their heyday, the Hittites were a powerful, well-organized and cultured people, and they had some very fine buildings. Over there in the distance you can see their temple area. It had well-paved roads, and there was this huge area that was for the temple purposes. And then there is a very strange stone. It's a green stone, and it doesn't come from this area. It came from a totally different area. And that also was a rather puzzle, because nobody knew just where it came from, and nobody can figure out just what it was used for. They had these huge storage jars, and they had a very smart way of doing their buildings. You'll notice these drilled holes here. Well, this is an earthquake-prone area, and so naturally stone buildings would tumble down. So what they had was stone foundations, and then they used a wooden superstructure with tenons into these holes, so that if there was a bit of a rumble, the building would stay intact. But the end finally came. It is usually considered to be in about 1200 BC, when they were annihilated by the peoples of the sea. Personally, my own opinion is that it was later than that, in fact, centuries later, because, for instance, we have the records of Shalmaneser III, in which he records his wars against the Hittites. We have even Sennacherib in the 8th century BC, who talks about fighting against the Hittites. So I think that their final end actually came at the hands of the Assyrians. However, it certainly came, and then they were lost and forgotten. And the critics even denied that they existed. They scoffed at the Bible record and said, just another Bible blunder. But remember, the Bible retained a record of them. And today, of course, everyone knows the Hittites. You've got the Hittite Hotel, you've got the Hittite Restaurant, you've got the Hittite Antique Shop and the Hittite Taxi Company. It's a very well-known people today. But it was only the Bible that preserved a knowledge of them. Remember, in 1861, just 8.5 lines in the Encyclopedia Britannica. But the Bible retained the record. And let me tell you, the Bible is a fascinating book. And I can assure you, it is historically reliable.
Well, I agree. The Bible's a great book, but I do suggest that you get a translation in modern English. I find it much easier to read. In our next program, we'll be taking you to the cradle of civilization, where history began. And David will be telling the exciting story of Henry Layard unearthing the winged bulls of Assyria, and Henry Rawlinson scaling the Behistun Rock to find the key to cuneiform writing.